Assalamu alaikum students, welcome back to my channel. I am Ms. Javeria and I am going to deliver the third lecture for grade 10 students today. First of all, thank you so much for your support and I would urge you all to please participate in the comments below and tell me what you want to hear from me in my next lecture. Also, if there are any queries, you can just comment down below and I'll answer to your queries separately. Let's start with our chapter for today. First, let's have a look at the recap of what we've learned so far in our videos. In our previous video, we learned about the key aspects of the 1973 Constitution. There were total 12 points that explained our 1973 Constitution. Then we had a look at General Ziaul-Haq era, where he ruled for about 11 years. And he's the only person to rule over Pakistan for such a long period of time in one go. And then he introduced some Islamization process. He took some steps for that, in which he strengthened our country over a religious point of view and introduced many points related to Sharia. Then Muhammad Khan Janejo stepped up as our prime minister and lifted the martial law. But the Ojri camp disaster was proved to be fatal for his government and he was dismissed again by President General Zia. Now in today's lecture, we will be having a look at the Afghan Jihad and the refugee problem and their impact on Pakistani society. And afterwards, we'll be delving into the functioning of the Benazir government. So without further ado, let's start with our chapter. Okay, there was a massive influx of Afghan refugees into Pakistan following the Soviet military intervention in Afghanistan in December 1979. Pakistan fully supported Afghanistan in this jihad and gained a US as its ally. Because of course you know that Soviet Union and USA are arch rivals, so definitely US supported Pakistan to withdraw the troops of Soviet Union. Now some people say that this Islamization process was also linked to this. How? For instance, like we were raising Islamic culture, Islamic belief, we were revolutionizing our country over religion. And that is why when we say a religion, we automatically start advocating all the narrations too. For instance, in our religion, jihad is allowed. And so when Soviet Union attacked Afghanistan, we basically called this our jihad, our war. And we sent our troops to Afghanistan to help Afghanis and those people so they could drive out the Soviet Union troops. Of course, Pakistan played its part very well. At the end of this jihad, Soviet Union did not remain Soviet Union for long, basically. And it crumbled to different states, now that we know as Russia. But the war itself brought so many consequences that Pakistan is still struggling because of this. What are those consequences? The presence of Afghan refugees brought a heavy burden on Pakistan's resources on account of sustaining the 2.8 million Afghan refugees. Like we have to sustain our people as well and also the Afghan refugees. Then the friction between Afghan refugees and the Pakistani population due to land, employment, animal grazing pasture and water supply disputes. These are all linked to refugee problem. Then there was a direct threat to Pakistan's internal security and political stability, which is made evident by numerous violations of Pakistan's western borders by Soviet Afghan air and ground forces in pursuit of the refugees and Afghan Mujahideen. At this present juncture, Afghan refugees have also become a principal factor in determining Pakistan's Afghanistan policy. Okay, so how did this jihad or how did this war start? Let's have a look at that. The USSR entered neighboring Afghanistan in 1979. attempting to shore up the newly established pro-Soviet regime in Kabul. In short order, nearly 100,000 Soviet soldiers took control of major cities and highways. Rebellion was swift and broad, and the Soviets dealt harshly with the Mujahideen rebels and those who supported them, leveling entire villages to deny safe havens to their enemy. Foreign support propped up the diverse group of rebels pouring in from Iran, Pakistan, China, and the United States. In this brutal 9-year conflict, an estimated 1 million civilians were killed, as well as 90,000 Mujahideen fighters and 18,000 Afghan troops and 14,500 Soviet soldiers were killed. The moral support of the government of Pakistan raised the morale of Afghan Mujahideen, and the Mujahideen inflicted heavy defeats on Russian forces in every field. Russia was completely demoralized and became helpless in 1986, but the jihad still continued. The continuous defeats disappointed the Russians tremendously, and that is why today USSR has broken down to Russia. The year 1988 was a turning point in the world politics. In this year, a disastrous decade came to an end that caused much bloodshed and destruction in Afghanistan and threatened the security of Pakistan. Geneva Accord has a very significant role in changing the political scenario of the world. It is obvious that the Pakistan's international credibility boosted due to Geneva Accord and became an important mediator in the world affairs. Pakistan, Soviet Union, Afghanistan, and USA were the participants of the Geneva Accord, in which Pakistan played a key role in settling the terms to resolve the Afghan issue. In spirit, Geneva Accord was an agreement between Afghanistan and Pakistan in which Soviet Union and USA were the guarantor of non-interference and non-intervention of each other's internal affairs. The Geneva Accord also solved the issue of security threats to Pakistan by the Soviets, because during the Afghan War, Soviet Union threatened Pakistan several times and warned that Pakistan was playing with fire due to its support to Mujahideen. After a few months of Geneva Accord, the accident of Zia's plane is also considered a conspiracy of Soviets that can be taken as or might be a part of US plan to get rid of Zia. Moreover, US stopped all the assistance that was promised and given during the Afghan crisis for the settlement of refugees. US sanctions made it very difficult for Pakistan to bear the burden of refugees, although it is included in Geneva Accord that 1.5 million refugees would return to Afghanistan. The chaos and civil war in Afghanistan did not provide the safe way of returning the refugees. To sum up, although the Geneva Accord was a victory of heroic Afghans along with a high watermark of Pakistan's diplomacy and military strategy, but it left various repercussions to issue in the region. Diplomatically, it was a successful effort in which, for the first time in the history of Soviet Union, withdrew her forces from a country. Socially and economically, the aftermath of Geneva Accord proved very hard and difficult for Pakistan. So basically, America and Russia signed this accord in April 1988 in Geneva, which is why it's called as Geneva Accord. And Russia withdrew its forces from Afghanistan on 15th February 1989. This, they call, was the end of so-called jihad. The repercussions were that Pakistan had to bear 30 lakh Afghan refugees which migrated to Pakistan. No doubt Pakistan gave shelter to the refugees and looked after them properly out of Islamic Brotherhood and human sympathy. The services of General Muhammad Zia-ul-Haq were praised in Afghan jihad, and Pakistan was appreciated internationally for the successful Afghan policy. But as we've already discussed, the sanctions by US, basically US was playing the main role in supporting us, and then it also barred us with sanctions, which was quite shocking to Pakistan. Coming to the topic of Benazir Bhutto's first government era, which was from December 1988 to August 1990. A charismatic woman, first ever lady to win the elections and take an oath as Prime Minister of Pakistan. The Moran Muslim State. although she inherited her father's party, the Pakistan People's Party, and beneficiary of dynastic politics and the emotional ties of a large section of the electorate to her charismatic family, has proven to be a mixed political blessing and has led it to victory. The party won a narrow plurality in the 1988 elections and was therefore forced to enter into a coalition with the MQM and several other parties in order to form a government. So basically Nawaz Sharif was her strong opponent. So what did Benazir did? She entered into a coalition with the MQM. Why MQM? Because of course Benazir belonged from the Sindh and MQM belonged to the party of Karachi. So this was much more viable than either asking Nawaz Sharif for a coalition. Benazir basically wanted to repeal the 8th Amendment in order to strengthen her position as Prime Minister, but soon abandoned her effort. Benazir also faced not only the old problems of the political role of the military forces, the division of power between the central and provincial governments, and the role of Islam, but also pressing new ones, including a large budget deficit and a growing ethnic violence. So now let's have a look at what steps she took in her first government era. So the first step taken by Benazir Bhutto was the dissolution of the Balochistan Assembly. The Chief Minister of Balochistan, Mir Zafarullah Khan Jamali, had just not gained the vote of confidence from the Balochistan Assembly in 1988. So the Benazir Bhutto government dismissed it. But why Benazir Bhutto dismissed Jamali? That is itself a question. So let's delve deeper. After the imposition of martial law in Pakistan by General Ziaul Haq, Zafarullah Jamali allied with Ziaul Haq. Jamali was appointed as a state minister in the federal cabinet by General Ziaul Haq. Jamali was elected as the member of National Assembly of Pakistan in 1985 general elections from Nasirabad constituency and was inducted into the federal cabinet of Junejo and given the portfolio of federal minister of water and power. Jamali was even appointed as the caretaker chief minister of Balochistan in 1988 after General Ziaul Haq dismissed the government of Junejo. Jamali was re-elected as the member of the Provincial Assembly of Balochistan in 1988 general election and became the Chief Minister of Balochistan. And that is when Benazir Bhutto government dismissed it. So the Balochistan High Court took up the case, declared it as unconstitutional and restored the house. So you can see the politics of Pakistan that Benazir Bhutto basically did not want any sort of allies of General Ziaul Haq. The second event is of the presidential elections. Now Ghulam Ishaq Khan won the presidential elections against Nawab Zada Nasrullah Khan in December 1988 and took the oath for the office. So Ghulam Ishaq Khan is the new president of Pakistan. Then a little ray of sunshine for Pakistan that after separation from the Commonwealth in 1972, Pakistan rejoined it in 1989. Now coming to the foreign policy of Benazir Bhutto. Since Benazir took the office in the crucial decade of Cold War, during her first government, Benazir Bhutto's foreign policy revolved around Afghanistan, India and the United States. On the Western Front, Benazir Bhutto also authorized further aggressive military operations in Afghanistan to topple the fragile communist regime and the Soviet influence in the region, all because of being the sidekick of the United States, basically. She then even wanted friendly relations with India. She adopted a no-confrontation policy with India, so when Rajiv Gandhi visited Pakistan to participate in the 4th SAARC conference, Benazir Bhutto joined hands for establishing good relations with him. But why did she want friendly relations with India? Because at the back end, Benazir Bhutto was establishing a separate but integrated nuclear testing program in the atomic bomb program. Benazir Bhutto even launched and supervised the clandestine project Integrated Research Program, a missile program which remained under Benazir Bhutto's watch and successfully ended in 1996. Pakistan's first military satellite, that is Badr 1, was also launched under her government through China. She declared 1990 a year of space in Pakistan and conferred national awards to scientists and engineers who took participation in the development of this satellite. So that is why you need to be a diplomat for being a very good leader of Pakistan. Not only Pakistan, but any state of the world. Then coming back to her social welfare programs, the government had launched the People's Work Program for development and social welfare of the country. For providing employment to the public, a department placement bureau was set up. Thousands of people got employment through it. Now moving on to the dismissal of the Benazir Bhutto government. Midnight Jackal was a political intelligence operation launched under President Ghulam Shah Khan and the Chief of Army Staff General Mirza Islam Beg, with the objectives to bring the vote of no confidence movement in the parliament by bribing the members of Benazir's own party. Basically, when Bhutto first became prime minister, she appointed herself as the new treasury minister with her mother as a senior minister without portfolio and her father-in-law as chairman of the parliamentary public accounts committee. Most of these in the administration had little political experience. Various members of the PPP old guard, including Mumtaz Ali Bhutto, left the party in frustration at the pro-capitalist direction she had taken. So there was already some resentment towards her within her own party. And then this intelligence operation heightened everything. For instance, in the 1980s, ethnic violence had broken out in Sindh province, with most of those killed being Muhajirs. Late 1989, the MQM, whose party represented Muhajir interests, left Bhutto coalition government and joined the parliamentary election. The MQM then joined other voices in calling for a general strike in protest at her government in May 1990. She ordered the army to restore peace in Karachi and Hyderabad. Within months, Bhutto's election dissolution had set in. Her narrow majority in the National Assembly had left her unable to reverse many of the Islamist reforms that Zia had introduced. This was also because Benazir needed permission from Khan for imposing new policies, which Khan vetoed as he seemed to moderate or contradict to his point of view. Benazir, through her legislators, also attempted to shift parliamentary democracy to replace the semi-presidential system. But again, President Ghulam Shah Khan's constitutional powers always vetoed Benazir's attempt. This brought power struggle between the Prime Minister and the President. Throughout her first term, Bhutto was criticized for being indecisive and unable to maintain control. There had also been anger that her husband had been allowed to attend cabinet meetings despite not being a member of the government. He was also accused of receiving kickbacks and gained the nickname Mr. 10%. The ISI had extensively spied upon Bhutto and her husband throughout her period in office. President Khan privately paid plaintiffs to file corruption suits against Bhutto's husband. While the investigations into his corruption were therefore politically motivated, there also was significant evidence of his guilt in this regard. Tales of corruption in public sector industries began to surface, which undermined the credibility of Bhutto. The unemployment and labor strikes began to take place, which halted and jammed the economic wheel of the country, and Bhutto was unable to solve these issues due to the Cold War with the president. In November 1990, after a long political battle, President Ghulam Shah Khan, using the powers under Section 58(2)(b) of the Constitution, dismissed the Benazir Bhutto government on the charges of corruption and dissolved the National Assembly on 6th August 1990. Her first government lasted for about 20 months. He claimed that this was necessary owing to her government's corruption and inability to maintain law and order. A caretaker government under the control of former PPP member Ghulam Mustafa Jatoi was sworn in, with Khan declaring a state of national emergency. And that is how we see Bhutto conceding her defeat. Now, before delving into the Benazir Bhutto's second government era, let's have a look at what was happening between 1990, that is the August 1990 to October 1993. Ghulam Isha Khan had called for new elections. In the meantime, Bhutto and her husband were forbidden from leaving Pakistan. In October, Zardari was arrested on charges of extortion. According to the allegations, he had attached a remote control bomb to the leg of a businessman and forced the latter to enter a bank and withdraw money. He was convicted and remained in prison for 3 years. In the 1990 general election, the PVP only secured 45 out of 217 seats. The IJI, under the leadership of Nawaz Sharif, won a majority in the parliament and Sharif became the prime minister. Bhutto became the leader of the opposition. From this position, she attacked Sharif's every policy, highlighting his government's failings in dealing with Pakistan's problem of poverty, unemployment, and lack of healthcare. Although not discussing her own administration's failures on those same issues. To journalists, she remained unrepentant about her period in office, insisting that she had made no mistakes. As dissatisfaction with Sharif's government grew, the PPP began to restore the support it had lost during Bhutto's premiership. Encouraging public protest in November 1992, she organized a 10-mile march from Rawalpindi to Islamabad in protest at the IJI government. Sharif ordered her to be placed under house arrest to prevent her instigating any uprisings. Despite an economic recovery in the late 1993, the government faced public unease about the direction of the country and industrialization that revolved around and centered only in Punjab province. Amid protest and civil disorder in Sindh province following the imposition of Operation Cleanup, the IDA government lost control of the province. The People's Party attacked the government's record on employment and industrial racism. And so this was the first time that we sowed the seeds and watered basically with the allegations that the Punjab province is taking the higher surplus or the Sindh province is taking the higher surplus, basically both the provinces clashing out with each other. Sharif had attempted to reduce the president's power. Relations between Sharif and President Khan also soured, and the prime minister came under pressure to resign from the armed forces. With growing tensions between him and President Khan in April 1993, the latter used the 8th Amendment again, the famous 8th Amendment, to dismiss Sharif as prime minister, citing corruption and misadministration. An agreement was reached whereby both Sharif and Khan would step down. The military formed an interim government and called a general election for October 1993. Their policies were very similar, but Bhutto promised price support for agriculture, pledged a partnership between government and business, and campaigned strongly for the female vote. In 1993, Bhutto declared herself as the chair of PPP for life. This move reflected the lack of internal democracy within the party, which was increasingly referred to as the Bhutto Family Party. Murtaza, who was living in asylum in Syria, decided to take part in the forthcoming election. Bhutto did not want him to join the PPP, fearing him as a potential challenger to her leadership of the party. Conversely, their mother supported Murtaza's political career. And that is how the family feud started. Also, not to forget, Zardari was freed from prison after Bhutto returned to office in 1993. On 19th October 1993, Benazir Bhutto was sworn as Prime Minister for the second term, as in 1993 elections, the PPP won the majority of the seats. Benazir Bhutto had learned a valuable experience and lesson from the presidency of Ghulam Isha Khan, and the presidential elections were soon called after her re-elect. After carefully examining the candidates, Benazir Bhutto decided to appoint Farooq Lughari as for her president, in which Lughari sworn as 8th President of Pakistan on November 14, 1993, as well as first Baloch to have become president since the country's independence. When Benazir became the Prime Minister, that was a time of great racial tension in Pakistan. And if Bhutto government fails, everyone knew that there will be no new elections, the army will take over. The racial violence in Karachi were reached at its peak and became the biggest problem for Benazir Bhutto to counter. The MQM attempted to make an alliance with Benazir Bhutto under her own conditions, but Benazir Bhutto refused. Soon the second operation, Operation Blue Fox, was launched to politically vanish the MQM from country's political spectrum. The results of this operation remains inconclusive and resulted in thousands killed or gone missing, with majority containing Urdu speaking. The following are the important events of the second term. During Benazir Bhutto's second term, construction of Karachi flyover bridge and Lahore bypass was started. Benazir Bhutto set up the Kisan Bank for providing loans to farmers and launched the National Tractor Scheme. Social and health policies were framed for women. Women police stations and courts were set up for providing legal facilities to this class. She even appointed women judges and a women's division in the government headed by a senior female civil servant. The fundamental Islamic laws introduced to restrict women's rights under Zia nevertheless remained in place, and no new legislation was put in place to empower women. Bhutto's failure to remove the Hudood Ordinance brought criticism from liberal classes and damaged her relations with women and human rights groups. But nonetheless, the government launched the 8th five-year plan, which resulted in rapid development and prosperity of the country. But that was only on paper. Bhutto was an economist by profession. Therefore, during her terms as Prime Minister, she herself took charge of the Ministry of Finance. Benazir disagreed with her father's nationalization and socialist economics. Soon after the collapse of Soviet Union, Benazir attempted to privatize major industries that were nationalized in the 1970s. So basically, she was taking a U-turn from her own father's objectives. Pakistan suffered a currency crisis when the government failed to arrest the 30% fall in the value of the Pakistani rupee compared to the United States dollar. Soon, economic progress became her top priority, but her investment and industrialization programs faced major setbacks due to conceptions formed by investors based upon her People's Party nationalization program in the 1970s. By the 1990s, Khan and Bhutto's government had also ultimately lost the currency war with the Indian rupee, which beat the value of Pakistan rupee for the first time in the 1970s. Bhutto's denationalization program also suffered from many political setbacks, as many of her government members were either directly or indirectly involved with the government corruption in major government-owned industries. And her appointed government members allegedly sabotaged her efforts to privatize the industry. Overall, the living standard for people in Pakistan declined as inflation and unemployment grew at an exponential rate, particularly as the UN sanctions began to take effect. According to a calculation completed, the standard of living for the rich improved while the standard of living for the poor declined. Benazir even attributed this economic inequality to be a result of ongoing and continuous illegal Bangladeshi immigration. Bhutto ordered a crackdown on and deportation of illegal Bangladeshi immigrants. Her actions strained and created tensions in Bangladesh-Pakistan relations, as Bangladesh Prime Minister Khalida Zia refused to accept the deportees and reportedly sent two plane loads back to Pakistan. Religious parties also criticized Bhutto and dubbed the crackdown as anti-Islamic. So Bhutto, following her former Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif's privatization policies, somehow the privatized money was avoided, not spent on people's living standard. And it was in 1997 when it was founded that the amount gained in privatization had gone somewhere else, and it was nowhere to be found in government's account. Now coming to her foreign policies. Benazir Bhutto sought to strengthen the relations with the socialist states, and Benazir Bhutto first visited Libya to strengthen the relations with then Socialist People's Republic of Libya. Benazir Bhutto also strengthened relations with communist state Vietnam and visited Vietnam to sign the mutual trade and international political cooperation between both the countries. She also wanted to have good relations with India, but due to Kashmir issue and Indian nuclear program, she failed to get the desired results. Mrs. Bhutto made successful visits to Iran and Turkey and gained moral support of these countries on Kashmir issue. The year of 1996 was crucial for Benazir Bhutto's policy on Afghanistan when Pakistan backed extremely religious group the Taliban, took power in Kabul in September 1996. It was during Benazir Bhutto's rule that the Taliban gained prominence in Afghanistan and many of her government, including her authorization, had backed the Taliban for gaining the control of Afghanistan. She continued her father's policy on Afghanistan, taking aggressive measures to curb down the anti-Pakistan sentiments in Afghanistan. Under her government, Pakistan had recognized the Taliban regime as legitimate government in Afghanistan, allowing the Taliban to open an embassy in Islamabad. Coming to the National Front, the government of the Chief Minister Pir Sabir Shah of the Muslim League and the Assembly were dissolved in 1994 in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, and Aftab Ahmed Sherpao of the People's Party was elected as Chief Minister. Before going to the topic of the dismissal of a government, let's have a look at what was the relations with military and how Bhutto was handling it. During her second term, Benazir Bhutto relation with Pakistan Armed Forces took a different and pro-Bhutto approach. When she carefully appointed General Abdul Wahid Kakkad as the Chief of Army Staff, General Abdul Wahid was an uptight, strict and a professional officer with the view of westernized democracy. Benazir also appointed Admiral Saeed Mohammad Khan as Chief of Naval Staff, General Abbas Khattak as Chief of Army Staff, while Air Chief Marshal Farooq Firoz Khan was appointed Chairman Joint Chief, who was the first and to date only Pakistani air officer to have reached to such 4-star assignment. Benazir Bhutto enjoyed strong relations with the Pakistan Armed Forces, and the President, who was handpicked by her, did not question her authority. She handpicked officers and promoted them based on their pro-democracy views, while the President gave constitutional authorization for their promotion. Now, why did the rift start between Bhutto and then the President, Mr. Farooq Ahmed Lakhani? So Benazir had a brother, Murtaza, who returned to Pakistan in 1993, claiming that it was he rather than his sister who was the standard bearer for their father's championing of the downtrodden. On arrival, of course, he was arrested. But in 1995, he established his own party, the PPP Shaheed Bhutto. The party's name implied that he was closer to the Bhutto's family, Shaheed, than his sister. Animosity grew between the two siblings. Murtaza focused much of his criticism on Bhutto's husband Zardari, whom he blamed of being responsible for government corruption. Not long after, on 20th September 1996, Murtaza was ambushed by police near Karachi. They opened fire, killing him and 7 others. It was widely believed in Pakistan that the killing had been ordered by a senior government figure. Murtaza's supporters thought that Bhutto and her husband were responsible. At the funeral, Nusrat, the mother, who was suffering from the early stages of Alzheimer's disease, also blamed Bhutto for her brother's death. Bhutto initially blamed the killing on a conspiracy against her family. After Murtaza's death, Bhutto re-established a relationship with her mother. After Bhutto hinted that President Lakhani had been involved in her brother's death, relations between the two broke down. It was then on 4th November 1996, Bhutto's government was dismissed by President Lakhani primarily because of corruption, who used the 8th Amendment discretionary powers to dissolve the government. Benazir was surprised when she discovered that it was not the military who had dismissed her, but her own hand-picked puppet president who had used the power to dismiss her. Her younger brother's death had a devastating effect on Benazir's party and policies. In the 1997 general election, some Pakistani feminist groups refused to back Bhutto's re-election because, despite her repeated promises, she had not removed the Hudood Ordinance that Zia's administration had introduced. So this marks the Benazir Bhutto's rule over the country for about 3 years this time. Thank you for listening to our lecture. If you like this video, kindly hit the like button. Also, don't forget to subscribe our YouTube channel. All the videos will be uploaded on our YouTube channel for the completion of syllabus. Also, hit the bell icon for getting updates regarding the YouTube videos. If you love this video, please don't forget to share it with your family and friends. Thank you so much. Allah Hafiz.